Davis is with us in Raleigh. Hi, Davis. How are you?
I'm fine, Mr. Ramsey. How are you doing?
Better than I deserve. What's up?
All right. So I have $21,140 in debt, just under $15,000 in the bank. I have a vintage car worth $4,500, and I can sell personal assets up to $2,000. I had a high-end engine business that I was running that I had to shut down due to the fact that I had been scammed once and then lied to right after that, which helped, which made me build up this debt. I had been leveraging the engines via debt with my brother, which, looking back on it, was a very poor decision.
Agreed.
I'm wondering, since I'm struggling to pay back this debt, as you can tell, I'm kind of young, how do you think that I should either try and settle this or, you know, settle some of it off while paying some of it with my brother and still maintain a healthy relationship with him?
Because you owe your brother the $15,000?
I do. I owe my brother.
No, I mean $21,140.
Right. I owe $1,500 to my dad and the rest to my brother.
Okay. And you have $15,000 cash in the bank?
Right.
Okay. And how old are you?
I'm 14.
14?
Yes. Yes, sir.
And how old is your brother?
He's 16.
Dude, do you know how weird this sounds?
I know. It sounds crazy, but I've just, you know, I've always done entrepreneurial things. But just, I started looking into debt, and this was before I got to you, and I thought I could build the business. And for a while, it was working. It was
Where was, like, your father that did not allow you to go $21,000 into debt to your brother, who's 16, when you're 14? Where's your father? I want to box his ears.
He's pretty angry about it, understandably now.
He stood there and allowed it to go on. I don't have 14-year-olds doing $21,000 transactions under my roof, and I don't know what the flip's going on. Okay.
Right.
Take the $15,000 out of the bank and pay your father the $1,500, I guess. He should probably be penalized more than $1,500 for being a doofus as a dad. But pay him the $1,500 and pay the rest of your brother. Sell your vintage car, and I think your brother's paid off then, right?
Right. Should
yeah.
be.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You don't need a vintage car when you're 14 anyway. Not a lot you can do with it.
All right.
And it's probably older. It's probably older than you are. So, yeah, just get rid of it and clean up this mess and learn the lesson. And, dude, I got to tell you, this is a weird call. I'll just be truthful with you. You need to understand. It's awesome that you could be involved in a business that was that big a deal at 14, but for your parents to allow this kind of disaster to occur under their roof to their own child is irresponsible. And I'll just say that out loud, just so you can hear me and your dad can hear me, and he can be pissed at me later. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. Open phones at 888-825-5225. Listen, you want to let your teenagers experience the pain of their bad decisions, but not with that many zeros on it. I mean, I want them to make a bad decision and have to fix something that's $1,000 or $500, and they got to work their way out of it, and it's a real pain, and it costs them half their summer because they made some bad decisions, that kind of stuff. I want my teens to make decisions and have the results of the decisions land on their head. That's called being a grown-up, and it's me teaching them to be a grown-up. But I don't put that many zeros on the end of it to where a kid is hung out to dry at that level. And so, wow. That's just astronomical. Yeah. Those of you wanting to teach your teens, and for that matter, preteens, how to handle money, Smart Money, Smart Kids is how we raised ours. That's the book that Rachel Cruz and I wrote together that we raised our kids with. And we allowed them to experience the pain of their stupidness, but not with the zeros on the end like that. I mean, we want them to feel the pain, and we want them to be entrepreneurial and understand what risk feels like and all of that. But, oh, my goodness, I thought I was talking to a 25-year-old. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. Jeremy is with us in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Hi, Jeremy. How are you?
Hi there, Mr. Ramsey. Doing great. How about yourself?
Better than I deserve. What's up?
Hey, wife and I are both recent graduates. We have an amount of debt, looking at $290,000 in student loans.
Good God. Who's the doctor?
My wife has her doctorate of physical therapy. I have a master's of environmental health and safety, a bachelor's of chemistry. And my question is, would it be a bad decision to purchase some rental properties to increase our cash flow?
You're broke. You're a $300,000 in debt, and you call me up and want to buy a rental property. No, 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 no. You have a crisis. You're Congress. You have a mess. No, 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 no. You are on beans and rice, rice and beans. No vacation. You will not see the light of day. You will work like an animal until you get this mess cleaned up. No, you don't buy rental property.
Okay, this is what we've done so far. We sold our house. Your program showed us we couldn't afford it.
Mm-hmm.
We sold our house. We paid off $10,000 in debt here lately. We have $37,000 cash that we have from selling our house. And the rental house we're in right now is $800 a month. We could buy a $60,000 house and have $400 mortgage and have an additional $400 to put toward debt was my viewpoint on it.
Yeah, that's assuming the renter pays.
Assuming the renter pays, yes.
And assuming it's rented.
Yes, and my
those are two pretty big assumptions.
We're on a suburb, and rental houses are extremely hard to find. They stay full, it seems like.
Okay.
So I'm a handyman. I did all the renovations myself on the last house. Anything that come up, I would do myself on these rental houses. And we could balance a home mortgage and a rental property mortgage right now cheaper than we could a rent house.
You have $300,000 in student loan debt, dude.
I know, yes, sir.
Don't talk to me about buying a rental house. Don't. I mean, I'm going to go visit Pluto in a minute. Don't do that. No. Please. Use the money to get out of debt. Keep your life simple. Quit trying to borrow your way through all of your dreams. You're turning them into nightmares. Pay off the debt. Kathy is in Orlando to start off this segment. Hi, Kathy. How are you?
Hi, I'm fine. Thank you. Thank you for taking my call.
Sure. What's up?
I was hoping you could help give me some sound financial advice during difficult marital times. Do you have any, is it any different than regular marital times? Like if you're having difficulties, like say your husband has a girlfriend.
Yeah, that'd be pretty difficult.
is this marriage
going to end?
It depends on him.
Really? You're pretty forgiving.
I'm really struggling. Well, he says they're just friends.
Yeah, when did you discover this?
Actually, he told me about it. He's like, oh, I'm just going. Well, the first encounter or visit with the ex-girlfriend, well, it's actually his ex-girlfriend from 25 years ago. He reconnected with her.
Facebook.
And no, not even. No, just, I don't know if it's that he's going through a midlife crisis. I don't know what's going on.
You need to see a counselor, darling.
Your brain's
jumbled up.
Yeah, it's kind of a mess.
Yeah, mine would be.
We're just friends.
Mine would be. Oh, no, no. There's a murder getting ready to be committed here.
Well, yeah.
You've got to. Yeah. You need to get some guidance because you're trying to be sweet and you're trying to believe it, and yet your brain, in your heart, but your brain is telling you this guy's cheating on you.
Yeah.
That's
I don't
bottom
think
line.
Sleepovers are cool thing. I've said this and he continued again just this month.
Okay.
He said, nothing's happening.
Oh yeah, darling, you are sweet. You're so naive. Okay. No, adults don't do sleepovers with people they're not married to of the opposite sex, okay? That is not normal. That's whacked.
That's what I said.
Okay.
That's exactly what I said.
You need to go see a counselor and you need to go see a divorce attorney. And then you need to decide which one you're gonna use. But Bubba needs game is up with Bubba here. He's played that as So, darling, the way you prepare financially, and I'm so sorry you're going through this, is you hold on. I'm going to talk to you when I come back. This is the Dave Ramsey Show, talking with Kathy in Orlando, and I had to get up off the floor to give her a proper answer. Her husband has reconnected with his old girlfriend from 26 years ago. He's doing sleepovers with the old girlfriend, says nothing's going on. And she's trying to figure out how to prepare in a bad marriage situation financially. Is that a fair summary of what you told me, darling?
Yes.
Okay. How long have you been married?
18 years.
I'm sorry. Okay. Well, let me just from an outside perspective tell you what the 12 million people listening to me right now are all thinking. Okay. Normal people that are married do not have sleepovers with the opposite sex ever in any circumstances that they are not married to. Okay? That's just not acceptable social behavior. It's nuts.
I've even said that. This isn't right.
I know. This is nuts. And the fact that he would try to play it off on that says that he has a level of BS in his life that is unbelievable. Okay? So he's off the ranch, kiddo, is what I'm saying. And I'm trying to be kind to you because you're hurting and you're sad, and I don't blame you. But you need to have the thing that's rising up inside of your throat validated, because you have to have that unless you have absolutely no self-esteem at all. You have to be going, this is nuts. So you need somebody outside to say, this is nuts. This is nuts. I just said it, okay? I want you to hear that really loud and clear. If I suggested to Sharon Ramsey that I was going to sleep over with someone of the opposite sex, I would not have the equipment to do so by the time I left the house, okay? You follow me? That's how this. That's how that works in the normal world, all right? And so it just, whoa, unbelievable. So are you in a church at all?
No, I'm not.
All right. Do you have access to someone that can recommend to you a good, solid marriage counselor that can walk you through the tough decisions and conversations that you're about to have? You need to get someone to get someone in your corner that way, okay?
I have a call out. He has refused to go with me, so
I have
a call right now.
Of course, because he thinks he
doesn't want to be ganged up on.
Yeah, he's got this thing. Yeah, he doesn't want to. Yeah. Well, let me just tell you, 12 million people just ganged up on him, all right? They're all listening to me. They're all going, he's nuts, all right? He just got ganged up on too late, and he deserves it because he's completely out of line. Listen, if you want to divorce your wife and then go sleep around, we can discuss that. I don't like that. That's a bad idea. But this is this con this guy's trying to run on you is just, it's ludicrous. It really says he thinks you're stupid, is really what it is. I mean, anybody that would believe this is stupid, and he thinks that about you. So you need to get a good counselor. Then the second thing you've got to get today, you've got to get with a counselor, and you've got to get with a good divorce attorney. I'm not saying you 100% are going to go through a divorce. That'll be your decision. But you need to have the information to know what it looks like, because information in the middle of high-stress scenarios, which you're in, helps you have power to make good decisions.
It's ugly, Dave. I've called a lawyer, and in the state I live in, it's 50-50 no matter what.
Yeah.
Adultery doesn't matter.
No, it doesn't.
So
that's right.
All the hard work, I'm the one who does the budget. I'm the one who's done all the planning.
Yep. That's the way it is in most states now. Okay. And so that part's ugly, but it's uglier to stay in an untenable situation. And I'm not suggesting it's over, but it probably is, statistically speaking. I mean, if you turn this around, you've beat the odds, so to speak. Right. So you go get some counselors to guide you through it. Now, what the attorney has taught you then is this. I've got a friend that does divorce recovery work all the time, and she has a wonderful saying. It's not a wonderful saying. It's an accurate saying. Divorce turns a marriage into a business transaction. And so it's now down to who gets what and when and access to kids or whatever. You get children?
No kids.
Okay. That part's a little cleaner. But it's just a matter of divvying up the stuff, and it becomes a business negotiation that is laced in anger and broken hearts and visceral emotions, but it's still a business negotiation at the end of the day. And so here's the interesting thing, and I will throw this in. If this is the track he decides to go on, and if it ends your marriage, he's going to want out quickly. And if I were negotiating on your side, I would make that cost him. He's going to give up some stuff in order for you to make this quick. I would drag it out and make it painful for a while, just because I'm that kind of guy. So, I mean, I'm serious, because it sounds like the way you described that a minute ago, there's some assets involved that are pretty serious.
Well, we don't have any debt, which is a huge thing.
That's good.
And our house is paid off.
That's good.
We're both putting 20%.
In other words, the court says you get 50%, but you can negotiate more than that in a settlement in Florida.
But the divorce lawyer, I need to find a better lawyer, because she was really cruel about it. And like, you'll just go, because I put him through school. And of course, or, you know, the last part of it anyway, the last year.
Yeah. What you want when you've got a divorce lawyer is you want someone that's kind of mean that you don't even really like them. Because this is a war.
I want to be nicer to me, yeah.
It's a war. It's a war. We're going to war. If you go that way, and I kind of think you're going to. I'm not telling you that's what you have to do, but I am telling you nobody is believing this BS line of his, okay? And so you need to get with a counselor that keeps you in between the ditches and reminds you that you are sane and he is not with this portion of the discussion. And then you need an attorney over here that's giving you advice on how to handle the money transactions and how to begin to negotiate the separation and when to throw him out and so on. And, you know, all of that. But your counselor will lead you through a series of, if they're a strong counselor, a series of discussions that says, okay, you know, we can continue to be married, but these are the rules if we're going to continue to be married. And if he doesn't want to go along with those rules, then we're not going to be married. And you have to set out some ultimatums for your sanity. Otherwise, you're the crazy one. And you're not.
Yeah. It makes me feel like I'm the one who's like, it's normal. I'm like, well.
No, this is not normal. This is not normal.
It's never happened in 17 years, I guess.
It's not. It's just not normal. It doesn't matter how long it's been. It's just not normal. Normal people don't do this crap. Okay. I mean, there's all kinds of weird stuff out there that's perverted and all that, but I'm talking about normal people. And either you're going to call something crazy that's crazy or you are crazy. There's really no in between. And so you have to kind of keep somebody in your corner while you're in these high stress scenarios that give you information on the legal side and give you information on the emotional, psychological, and spiritual side to guide you through this so that you can stay. So you make solid, good decisions that you don't regret later, that you weren't too harsh, but you were tough, and you weren't angry and bitter, but you allowed yourself to feel the emotions that are real. Okay?
Okay.
And you just got to have somebody walk with you, honey, and that's the thing. And I'm so sorry you're going through this, but I just want to validate some of those things that you're thinking are absolutely true. The reason I brought up Facebook is there's this ridiculous statistic that something like 20 to 30% of divorces have a Facebook contact to an old flame involved. And so there's this tremendous thing. And she said this one wasn't, but there's this tremendous problem out there of people looking up the old flame. Oh, I wonder what she looks like now. Most of the time you look her up and you're going, "Whoa, I did good." Or you look him up and you went, "Oh, really, son? Back up from the table." This is what happens most of the time when you look up an old flame, right? Or they look me up and they go, "Oh, where'd all his hair go?" So sometimes they reconnect. And we've had more than one set of friends lose their marriage to the reconnect to the old flame thing. And bad deal. No, I'm not calling Facebook the devil, but the devil lives there. Like he lives everywhere. So what a sad situation. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. Christopher is with us in Denver. Hi, Christopher. How are you?
Hey, Dave. How are you today?
Better than I deserve. What's up?
Well, I'm got a little concern here. My 24-year-old daughter recently moved out. And she got a job that she starts on Monday in Hutchinson, Kansas. And I was wondering, she's over $60,000 in debt from medical bills and things of that nature. How can I help her get on the same page that I am with the total money makeover?
Have you talked to her about it?
I have, but she's very resistant.
Okay.
She really doesn't know, you know, a whole lot about how to handle her finances.
Mm-hmm. And she has $60,000 in debt.
And it's accruing more every day.
Why? Why is it accruing more every day?
Well, she hasn't paid anything since, probably about 4 or 5 years ago.
Uh-huh. Okay. So what is the debt? I mean, is it all medical or what's the deal?
Mainly medical bills.
How much does she owe on her car?
She doesn't have one.
How much does she owe on her credit cards?
Well, she was smart. She didn't get one of those either.
So it's all medical? You say you keep it's saying mainly. Medical. What else is it?
Just like I said, it's just medical bills.
All right. So it is all medical bills then, not mainly.
That's right. Yes.
Okay. All right.
You're right.
What's she going to be making at her new job?
All she told me was she's going to be making $11 an hour starting Monday. Working as a caregiver for the elderly.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, you know, if you have, in order to guide an adult, whether they're your friend or your kid, they have to want guidance, be asking for guidance, and be willing to accept guidance. And I right now I'm not hearing any of that. I mean, that's why I don't talk to people here on the air that don't want help. They call me up and they want me to endorse their stupidity. I'm not doing that. The problem is when it's somebody you love, you kind of have to stand back and watch them do stupid. If you try to keep them from it, they won't. They're going to do it anyway because they're allowed to be stupid. That's the privilege of an adult. It sounds like this kid's a bit rebellious.
Uh-huh.
She's like busting out and going and making $11 halfway across the country from her parents.
Mm-hmm.
It sounds like she's up for a bump on the head. I'm afraid she's going to get some more bumps on the head. What was the nature of the medical bills? What happened?
Children. She's had about 6 kids.
She's 24 years old?
Mm-hmm.
I think I've touched on something with that rebellion thing, didn't I?
I think so.
Yeah. So where's the dad?
Well, that we're not sure of because she has got many kids from, all her kids are from different people.
I see. And where are all the kids?
Yeah, they're in foster care.
Okay. Oh, this kid, she's a mess. That's sad.
I mean, I'm just trying to help her out, but yeah. I don't have, you know, the tools myself to do that.
Yeah. I would just tell her that the total money makeover she has to read, when she's ready to turn her life around, you can show her how to do it. But, this girl is, she's making a lot of bad decisions, obviously.
Mm-hmm.
And I just, you can't make somebody take care of themselves and behave. Yeah. And they have to choose to do that. But I would just pray for her and ask her, tell her that, you know, when she wants some help with this stuff, that I'm standing here ready. Here, take this book with you, honey. And if you ever want to sit down and learn how to handle money, this will do it. But $11 an hour, the behavior patterns you're outlining for me, and $60,000 worth of medical debt, and halfway across the nation from her family, is not a good formula. There's nothing in this that sounds good. I wish I could be more hopeful, but the only thing that's good about all this is, and you've done it and I've done it, most of us have done it anyway, we've done stupid. We know what it looks like, and you get that bump on the head, and then you get the opportunity to turn your life around. And so hopefully hers will turn around sooner than later. But, I suspect that she has other issues entering into her money problems more than we're outlining right now as you and I discuss this. Hi, Ken. Welcome to the Dave Ramsey Show.
Hi, Dave. It's nice to talk with you. The reason that I'm calling is that I recently inherited a great sum of money, approximately $50 million. And I'm just wondering, what do you think I should do with this?
You're not kidding me.
No, I'm not kidding you.
Who in the world left you $50 million?
My parents.
Wow. What did they do?
My dad was into everything, real estate. He was an automobile dealer. He sold private jets.
Wow.
On and on and on.
So $50 million cash or worth of assets?
This is cash.
Goodness gracious. Okay. Have you managed wealth prior to this?
Yes.
Okay. So you were already wealthy?
I was comfortable.
Okay. All right. Nothing like this, but at least in the millions, okay.
Right.
I mean, 1 million would be wealthy, right?
Right.
That's called, as we all know, a millionaire. Everybody except Washington, which they think millionaire means you make a millionaire. But anyway, the thing that I do and that I teach people to do with all of their income, including an unbelievable sum like this, is to balance and use ratios between living some of it, enjoying some of it, in other words, giving some of it, and investing some of it. And so I would say, okay, how much of this do I want to systematically give? Because wealthy people who give are the ones that have fun with money. And I'm gonna spend some of it. I'm not gonna be, you know, stack it all up in a cave somewhere. And right. I'm gonna enjoy some of it. I've always wanted this car, or I've always wanted to go on this trip, or I've always gonna buy this for my wife, or whatever, that kind of a thing. But it's not a lot. It doesn't have to be a lot. It doesn't have to be a very big percentage with this much money, and it's a lot of money.
Right.
You know, just kind of blow money almost, and then a percentage to invest yet for the next generation. Okay. And to create income to do even yet more giving and so forth. So I would sit down and think in ratios like that and say, okay, I'm gonna give this. Now, I'm an evangelical Christian, so I tithe. That's a tenth of my income before I start anything. And then I do giving additionally to that on my ratio. And then I invest a ratio and I spend a small percentage. But you're going to have a lot of the spending portion is going to be, doesn't take much here for it to be a lot of fun. Greg's in Oklahoma City. Hi, Greg. How are you?
I'm doing pretty well. Thanks, Dave. I really appreciate you taking my call.
Sure. What's up?
Where to start? I'm 42 years old, and I actually am the CEO of a business. I'm lucky enough to open it 9 years ago, and we're doing pretty well. The problem is I really don't have anything to show for it, and I really need advice on how to save. I have two children. I have a 16-year-old daughter and a 12-year-old son. You know, my 16-year-old will be going to college here pretty soon. She's a junior. I'm pretty much scared to death right now. I mean, the problem is we make plenty of money coming in. I have a spouse that has a spending problem. And I've actually had to tuck some money away, you know, just for mortgages. Basically, if it shows up in the bank account, it's like a race to zero. Anytime I deposit a check, it's a race to zero. And that's not the way I was brought up, and that's not the way I run my business. And
So what do you pay taxes? You own this business, right?
I do.
And how much do you make a year?
I make right at $260,000 a year.
Taxable income.
Taxable income.
And you have nothing.
I have a home. I have some cars, you know, but as far as retirement goes, I really don't have much. Mm-hmm. I don't. And it scares me to death. I mean,
what's not much? I mean, you got $10,000 or $100,000?
Well, I have about $50,000 cash that I've.
That you've hidden from your wife.
Yes. Yeah. The problem with that is that actually goes to my mortgage, because if the money's in the bank, you know, every time I deposit my paycheck, mm-hmm. which, you know, I don't know, it's like $1,800 a week or whatever. It's a race to zero. If I actually left that money in there for that month and went to pay a mortgage, the money wouldn't be there for the mortgage at the end of the month.
Yeah. So what happens to the other $160,000 a year? Because $1,800 a week is less than $100 a year.
Say that again. I'm sorry.
You said you made $260,000, but $1,800 a week is only $100,000.
Well, right. It's $110,000. That's my base salary. But we do get shareholder distributions throughout the year.
And where do those go? You know, into that same account?
Bonuses. And, you know, that money actually goes into the savings a lot. And then some do go into the checking account.
So where's all that gone?
I try to pull the majority of it out.
Where has all of that gone?
It's actually in a deposit box.
How much is in the deposit box?
Right at $50,000.
That's not even close. We're talking about $160,000 a year.
I know. Well, that's what I'm saying. The money, it's a race to zero.
Okay, so when you sit and talking to her about this, that your lives are completely out of control and you're spending like you're freaking in Congress, what does she say?
Exactly. She She actually feels really bad about it. She knows that it's wrong. She cries. We've had the, you know, come to Jesus talks. You know, I'm going to change. Just give me a cash and, you know, allowance. We've tried that.
And how old is she?
She is 43.
And how long have you been married?
We've been together since 94, and we were married in 98. So,
okay. Is she seeing a counselor?
Not for this, but she
needs
does
to.
For depression.
She needs to. Oh, bipolar?
No, she, you know, it could be. She has not been diagnosed with bipolar.
Well, this is a manic behavior.
It's absolutely insane because my daughter, luckily, and here's the thing, and this is her thinking, and from what she says, my daughter is very bright, and as a matter of fact, she turned us on to Dave Ramsey.
All right, stop a minute. Stop. Okay, here's the thing. Okay, we have to decide if your wife is being a doofus or if she has emotional mental issues. And if she's seeing a counselor for legitimate depression, and it's possible she's manic, that would explain this. In which case, you have to treat her as if she's got a mental issue, which she does. And that means she just has no access to money at all.
Gotcha.
Just take her off the account. Just open a new account. You manage the money because your wife is broken right now. And you care for her as if she's got a drug addiction or as if she's got cancer or as if she's got bipolar. And you take care of her until she walks through the healing process and is able to step back in and make an adult-like emotional contribution to this conversation. But you're asking someone who's broken to carry a load they can't carry when you dump that money into that account.
Right.
So
just
take it away from her. And it's not to punish her. It's because she can't, you know, if she was doing cocaine, we're not going to supply it.
Right.
Okay, because this is adding to her depression. When she's out of control like that, she wakes up with a depression hangover after this, is more depressed because she's more out of control.
Well, it's, you know, when I get my bank statement, it's Verizon, or not Verizon, but
I don't
Amazon,
care.
Amazon.
I don't care.
Know, it's
I don't care. What incredible. You've been doing is not working. You make $260,000 a year. You have nothing to show for it. There's a big freaking hole in the bucket. Quit using the bucket. Take the bucket away. Just, honey, I love you, and when you need some money, you come to me, and I will give you some money for whatever it is you're working on, but you're off of all accounts until we get your mental illness addressed.
Right.
Because that's where she is, dude.
Yeah, it's easier said than done.
No, it's not. Sit down with her and your counselor. Sit down with her and her counselor, because you're adding to her depression.
Right.
You're part of her problem.
You're right.
And so the
I'm
counselor,
enabling it.
Exactly, the counselor, well, you're making it worse because she gets more depressed because she feels like a doofus.
Right.
And so you need to sit down with the counselor and just go, baby, I'm taking you off of everything. And if she doesn't like that, let's go see a marriage counselor. And the marriage counselor will tell her the same thing if they got a brain in their head.
Right, exactly. I just feel like she's sabotaging everything that we've worked for.
No, it's because she's sick, buddy.
You're right.
You can't simultaneously treat her like she's got a mental illness and then on the other side come over here and act like she's a petulant teenager. Now, if she's a petulant teenager,
rationally, I understand.
It's not a rational transaction if that's what's going on. And then if it is a rational transaction, then we've just got a maturity princess issue, but that's nothing you've said in this conversation indicates that.
Okay.
So love her enough. Love her well. Take this responsibility off of her. She has no access to money, as if she's doing cocaine, starting today. And the only access she gives is you lovingly hand out little bits, and then you manage this household for the good of your future and your wife's future, called retirement, and the good of your kids' future. You make a ton of money, and you take control of this. You're the CEO of your house, too, my man. You can do this. And if you need some more help, you call me back. Susan's in New York. Hi, Susan. How are you?
I'm good, Dave. How are you?
Better than I deserve. What's up?
Okay, so I have 35 credit cards, and I owe $19,000 in them, $30,000 school loan, which I have not paid, and the school loan was from 2009. I still haven't paid because I'm always putting it off.
How much do you say, 30 on the school loan?
30 on the school loan because it's my husband's and I.
Okay.
So we both went to school. And a $19,000 credit card. Mm-hmm. Now, we take home $60,000.
Mm-hmm.
Now, I wanted to know, I wanted to pay off some credit cards, but every week it just seems that I'm paying something,
mm-hmm.
like all minimums.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just living paycheck by paycheck. So mm-hmm. I wanted to know, what can I do? In, I mean, 35 credit cards.
Mm-hmm.
So every week it is something. Should I pay off the ones that I owe the most and the other ones just put it for another month?
Okay. Are you ready to endure some pain to get rid of this mess?
It's going to leave us with hardly anything.
Are you ready to endure some pain to get rid of this mess?
Yes, I am.
What about
yes,
your husband?
Oh, yes. Yes, he is.
Okay. All right. Yes, and the two of you need to sit down together. Go on everydollar.com and do your budget tonight.
Okay.
You can download it to your iPhone or your Android or your desktop. It's free. It takes about 10 minutes to do your budget. Because what's happening now is you guys are just living from crisis to crisis to crisis to crisis to crisis. Check comes in, all the money goes out, and then you're broke, and you can't figure out how to go to the grocery store.
Yes, exactly.
You're not living by any kind of plan. This money is owning you. You don't own it.
Yes.
And you got to get the other side of it, and the budget helps you do that. You're telling your money what to do instead of wondering where it went. The first thing that will happen when you sit down and write out this month with the money you have right now and you give every dollar an assignment, every dollar a mission, that's why we call it everydollar.com. The first thing that will happen is you'll feel like you got a raise because you're going to go, where's all this money been going? Because disorganization leads to impulse and being stressed out and desperate leads to impulse.
Mm-hmm.
And you'll quit going out to eat because you can't afford to go out to eat. You're done with restaurants.
Yeah.
And you're not going on vacation either. Don't talk to me about a vacation. You're freaking broke.
Okay. Yeah.
And then when you finish every dollar, the next thing you need to do is get the 35 cards and put them on the center of the table and get your scissors out and cut up every single one of them.
Yes. Okay.
Every single one of them. You need plastic surgery really bad.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, definitely. Okay. Yes.
Now we have no credit cards. Now we have to live on a budget.
Okay.
And food's first.
Yeah.
So you're going to eat. Lights and water second.
Mm-hmm.
Before you pay anybody. And you take care of the house payment third, before you pay anybody.
Mm-hmm.
And you got car payments too?
No car payment. We did pay off our car.
Good.
Yeah, so that we don't want. But we do have private school. We pay for my daughter and babysitter for the baby.
And now when you squeeze every dollar out of this budget,
mm-hmm.
and you wring every dollar out of it, you're going to look down and go, okay, what do we got to cut out that we're doing that we can't afford to do anymore? And on top of what do we got to cut out, what can we do to increase our income? What do we got we can sell?
Mm-hmm.
And you start, everything that's not bolted down is going to get sold. You're not going on vacation. You're not going to a restaurant. You're taking extra jobs. You're going to start looking at your career. I mean, your whole household is only bringing in $60,000 and you live in New York City. That's tough.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You live in one of the most expensive places to live in the world.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, and it's just, it's doable, but you ain't got a lot of wiggle room here. And that's what's been happening. And every time a disorganization popped up or a crisis popped up, it went onto a credit card, and you were going backwards and backwards and backwards and backwards and backwards, and you've got to get back ahead of this thing. Then we're going to list our debts, smallest to largest,
mm-hmm.
and you're going to pay off the little one as fast as you can.
Okay.
And you're going to cheer and dance around the kitchen.
Okay.
And then you're going to pay off the next one, and you're going to cheer, and you're going to dance around the kitchen. And you're not only cheering and dancing around the kitchen because you paid off debt, you're doing it because for the first time in your life, you got control of your money.
No. Mm-hmm.
And that's what you got to do, because right now you feel out of control, scared, and broke.
Yes, exactly.
Which makes you normal, and that's sad.
Mm. And the school loan, I just can't even talk about the school loan.
Well, let's get these credit cards done. You don't have any credit card payments, we can start working on the school loan.
Okay.
That's the big one, though. And if you want to put them on deferment, I don't care.
Mm-hmm.
Let's just punch these credit cards in the face. But, I mean, you're working extra. You're doing everything you can. You got one goal, and that's get rid of this credit card debt as fast as you possibly can. And, I have a big garage sale this weekend. Put some stuff on eBay. Put some stuff on Craigslist. Let's turn some stuff into money.
Okay.
And turn this around. Now, I'm going to send you a copy of the book, The Total Money Makeover, which is the step-by-step game plan on exactly how to attack this and how to do this. And you guys, but your steps tonight are everydollar.com.
Okay.
Get your budget done. Cut your credit cards up. That's your first two steps.
Okay.
And then you and your husband are in agreement. We're going to sacrifice deeply because I am so sick of living like this.
Yes, definitely.
And when you get sick and tired, you're ready to change your life, kiddo.
Yes.
You can do it. And you call me back if you need help, okay?
Okay. Thank you, Dave.
All right. You hold on. I'll have Kelly pick up. I'm going to give you a Christmas present. It's the Total Money Makeover book. Merry Christmas to you. This is the Christmas you changed your life. Are you ready? Set. Go. Lee is with us in Washington, D.C. Hi, Lee. How are you?
I'm doing okay. Thanks. Good. Thanks for taking my call.
Sure. How can I help?
I've been married a long time, almost 18 years, and about 2 years ago, my husband found out that I had spent about $30,000 and didn't tell him. So within that time frame, we had lost a child. Mm-hmm. So he separated the money, and I went back to work to try to pay off my part of the debt. Well, when I realized I haven't really done much, so I asked him if he would take FPU with me. Previously, we had done your plan, but we hadn't taken FPU, and he told me no. He doesn't want to take it with me because he doesn't see any progress. So I'm just calling to find out if you think I should take it on my own.
Mm-hmm. How long have you been married? You said
18 years.
I'm sorry. How long ago was this that you disclosed that you had lied to him about $30,000?
I didn't disclose. He found out.
Oh.
I wish I would have disclosed. It would have turned out much better. About 2 years ago.
Mm-hmm. And what is the lack of progress is what in his mind, that you've not paid the debt down or that you're still just spending like crazy?
A little bit of both. Not spending like crazy, but not putting all of my money that I'm currently making or most of it on the debt.
Mm-hmm. What are you doing with it?
I have no idea. Foolishness, I guess. Not really anything. I buy things here and there, and I kind of pay the minimums on my debt, and that's about it.
Mm-hmm. Hmm. Well, this is a difficult deal because there's kind of two sides of the equation for me. Let me just kind of talk it out with you, okay? There's your side of the equation where you lied big time to your husband. He caught you, so he doesn't trust you anymore. Since then, you took a job, but that's really all you've done to fix the mess. Because more importantly than you not taking a job or taking a job is that you haven't changed anything. You're still disorganized. You're still not handling money. You're still spending it all. That's problem number one, one side of the equation. The other side of the equation is I really don't like a situation where a husband is treating a wife or a wife is treating a husband over a two-year period of time as if you're his daughter and he's punishing you, trying to make you learn a lesson or something. That's not a healthy marriage solution either. So I don't like his solution. I don't blame him for being pissed off, but I don't like his solution, and I don't like your behavior, your unwillingness to change. And so you guys really have a lot of stuff to work on. I do think the best scenario is for you to earn his trust by handling money well, but not by being abandoned by him, but by working with him. And so I think his abandoning you to your mess is unhealthy. And I think your lack of change is unhealthy because you're not, you know, I don't blame him for not trusting you. You haven't earned any. But I also do blame him for just leaving you out there on your own. You're not a petulant teenager. You're his wife of 18 years. And so, I would approach this a lot differently. It might even be more uncomfortable for you if I were married to you. Because we would be working on this, or we would be working in the marriage counselor's office to bring our marriage to an end. Because you're going to freaking get to... I'm not going to be married to somebody I can't trust.
Right.
Not for a long time. I mean, I'll work with you for a while, and I'm not lacking in grace, but eventually, you know, it's just like if someone's an alcoholic or if someone's, you know, doing drugs and they say, I'm clean. Well, the only way somebody wants to stay married to a former addict is they come clean, stay clean. But that when that trust is just continually broken, eventually they give up and they go, well, I would just be crazy to stay in this cycle. So, and that's kind of what he's facing, but he's not handling it very well. So, I think I would suggest FPU for both of you and marriage counseling for both of you. And if he won't go to either, I would just go to marriage counseling and wait on FPU until you can get him to go with you.
Okay.
Because I'm afraid this is going to make it worse. It might help you, but I don't want to drive a wedge between you and him any further. You follow me? I want your marriage to be healed. I don't want it to be any further than this. So.
And he did pay off all of anything with his name on it. He's paid off.
Yeah, I know, but there's a level of selfishness here on his part. I mean, if he gets sick, you got to make him soup in bed. So it's for better, for worse, for richer, for poorer, in stupid and not. Until death do us part. I mean, that's how that works. And so you're all in when you're married. It's not like, well, you know, this is not a joint venture where you can just go, well, I'm not going to fix my partner's problem. It's your wife, for goodness sakes. So now I tell you what you might do. And again, the big answer is you need a marriage counselor. Okay, big time, both of you. Now, the smaller answer might be, and don't do this instead. In other words, do that one. As a part of this, what if you sat down with him and said, okay, I'm going to go through financial peace. No, I'm not. I'm going to start working on my budget. Would you help me with it?
Okay.
Would you help me do a written plan? And then would you work with me and show me, because you're better at handling money than I am, and help me, you know, put together a game plan to pay down on this debt. And then if I do that for 2 months with you helping me, would you go to FPU with me then?
I will try that.
And try to earn some, try to create a conversation, a dialogue here. Then, you know, say, under what circumstances would you go to FPU? And will you help me with this? Or are you just going to abandon me? You know, because you're not saying I did a right thing. You're not defending it. I didn't hear you anyway. I think you said
no,
I did.
No,
I think
it was.
What I did was stupid.
Was foolish.
Yeah, yeah. Okay. So, I think you just reach out and go, hey, help me with this. And you're not asking, I'm not saying by help, I'm not saying ask him to write a check today. Although I think he should write checks, but I think that comes later. But I think today you're just saying, help me by coaching me and showing me how to do this and walking with me. And then I'll take my money and do with it what you would do if you were doing this. How would you handle it? And so, try to get him involved in your situation. And if I do that for 2 months or 3 months, would you agree then to go to FPU? And would you agree to sit down with a marriage counselor with me? Because we've got a mess here. Because you got some pretty seriously damaged trust. I tell you, Lee, what some people don't realize is this we call it financial infidelity in the financial coaching world. And for some people, it's hard to believe, but for some people, this broken trust is harder to get over than sexual infidelity. For some people. Now, that wouldn't be the case with me, but for some people, it touches the same place in your soul. Hey, Ann, how are you?
I'm doing fine, thank you.
Good. How can I help?
Have a situation with a daughter that we have just recently, in the last 3 weeks, found out has embezzled approximately $80,000 from our businesses. We have not, and that's just from 2014, the beginning of these first few months, 2013, and we still haven't been able, in 2012, we haven't gone back to 2011 yet.
Oh my Lord. But, how old is this girl?
28.
And what was her position with your firm?
She's still in the position. She's a manager.
And why is she still in the position?
To be honest with you, we need her for right now. We have implemented changes where, as my husband says, the hemorrhaging has stopped. There's no way, we had no idea, but he's implemented changes where it cannot be done now. But until we get somebody to replace her, we absolutely have to have her. For right now. And that's my question. I mean, we're taking it bit by bit, but I don't even know what to do other than we do need her in that position for right now.
What is your question of me?
For right now, I think my question is twofold. Number one, is it something that should be prosecuted? Number two, is it is there help in all your helpers that you have out there? Is there help for people that have an inner core problem with that? I don't even know how to, you know, if she's, she said she's interested in getting help, but I don't even know who to send her to.
Where's the money?
She has not indicated. She has not done, I honestly think that it's just, as I look back, I think it's shopaholic to the extreme, because there's nothing extravagant that you can see at all other than tons and tons and tons of clothes, shoes, jewelry, you know, stuff like that.
She's single?
Not now. Newly married.
And you guys own 100% of the business?
Yes, sir.
Okay. I can't imagine the heartbreak that you're facing. I don't know what we would do in that situation. If you can absorb the financial blow, I don't think I would prosecute criminally, but it would probably be contingent upon some very extreme actions on her part. And I have to tell you, I think you're absolutely ridiculous for leaving her in the building one more minute. I don't care how much you think you need her. You are completely, completely codependent if you think you need to leave a thief in the building. The very first thing that should have been done is her desk should have been cleaned out, and she should have been sent home with the understanding that we're going to decide whether we're going to criminally prosecute you on this, and that's going to be based on your level of repentance, which is going to be based on you telling us where every dime of this money went and getting a bunch of it back right quick, because some of it's probably still in her account somewhere. And you know, she hasn't even told you what she did with the money. I mean, my God, do you people not talk about anything? She stole $80,000 from you. I would have been all up in her business.
Right. I agree.
How can you possibly think you leave this person in the building?
And that's not a choice that I can make alone. That is a choice that my husband has to make, and that was his choice right now.
Yeah, and it's a bad choice. He's a bad leader. He's a weak leader, and he's going to lose more than the $80,000. He's going to lose the respect of his entire team, and he's probably going to end up losing revenue and lost customers as well, because this kind of weakness in leadership is a disease that will spread through an organization. And he's going to have to stand up, and he's got to man up. I know his little girl broke his heart. I get that. But the first thing he's got to do is get her out of the building. You would never keep an employee 10 seconds after they did embezzlement from you. Not 10 seconds. If they steal a roll of toilet paper, I'm not keeping them 10 seconds. They're a thief. Now, that's the employee part of it. And then you go over and say, okay, my daughter now has been accused of a crime, and now I've got to deal with my daughter. That's a separate issue. But we're going to deal with her from home, not from the office. And your husband desperately needs to step up into this. It's not a matter of being angry about it. It's a matter of wisdom and a lack of weakness versus strength. I mean, this is not, you're like sending out the signal this is okay by leaving her in the building. It's just unbelievable what you're telling your team. And you know, here's the thing. Your team probably knew some of this was going on. Depending on how big the team is, they probably smelled a rat. And now how you deal with that is going to dictate your all's future with these businesses. So I have my son-in-law works on our team. One of my daughters runs our family foundation. My other daughter works on our team. And I can tell you with 100% certainty, they would be out of the building instantaneously. They'd be gone if they stole $80,000. That day, they would go home. And then I would decide other things that are harder decisions. So whether I'm going to criminally prosecute my own kid, I don't think I would. I'll be honest with you. I think that's where the dad would come in rather than the leader. But this organization cannot absorb the blow of that level of nepotism, and yours can't either. That's just sad. But it's so heartbreaking. It's just, I can't breathe. I'm just thinking about, you know, if Rachel or Denise or Winston or somebody, I don't know. I mean, it would just rip the heart out of my chest and crush it and just stomp on it. I mean, what kind of psychopath steals from their parents? but they do. And this girl has deep psychological problems. This represents an unbelievable level of narcissism and other pathologies that that only a therapist is going to be able to outline for you. She's got to get some help. I mean, this is a broken, messed up person. Oh, how sad to have to face that with your own kid. I mean, it's tough enough for a small business to go through embezzlement and just the betrayal and the heartbreak of somebody you trusted that was on your team. But it's your daughter? I can't even imagine. Oh, Ann, I'm so sorry for y'all. But for goodness sakes, take action. For goodness sakes. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. Lynn is with us in Dallas, Texas. Hi, Lynn. How are you?
I'm great. How are you?
Better than I deserve. What's up?
Thanks for taking my call first.
Sure.
We need some advice on how to handle a situation with our daughter and son-in-law. They're both 27.
Mm-hmm.
She's once again unemployed, losing her third job in a year.
Why does she lose them?
Well, she just doesn't listen, I think. Can't get along with the people.
Okay.
Can't follow instructions.
So it turns out being a bud is not working out for her.
Right, but hadn't quite connected to her yet.
Gotcha. Okay.
She's been employed 22 weeks out of the last 61, but she does have a job that begins August 1st and is drawing unemployment until then.
Mm-hmm.
Neither of them have made an attempt to get a part-time job or to increase their income or cut their expenses, and quite honestly, they're insulted by the suggestion of doing that.
Mm-hmm.
We started early trying to teach her money management, but as you can tell, strong will, do what I want attitude, mm-hmm. followed through on that as other areas in her life.
Okay.
And I must say that she doesn't come to us unless it's an emergency. The last emergency situation, though, was a call from her husband that she was in jail.
Mm-hmm.
We learned then that she had had a minor car accident several months before that. To complicate it, their insurance had been canceled several months before that, mm-hmm. and her husband had not only not told her, but he hadn't gotten around to getting any replacement insurance.
Mm-hmm.
And then she ignored the court date, so she was hauled off to jail. So you can see the trail here of irresponsibility.
Yeah.
So after discussing the situation, we told her husband that we'd pay the $1,000 to get her out of jail if and only if they'd agreed to some accountability on getting their finances in order.
Mm-hmm.
And he agreed.
Mm-hmm.
However, a couple of days later, when I tried to set up the meeting to discuss it, he sent me a text saying that he would not talk with me, that he would give me progress updates on their financial situation as he chose, and any further discussion would be considered harassment and dealt with as such.
Okay. I can handle that.
I was able to meet with him long enough to say, okay, if you're not willing to, you know, agree, do what you agreed to do, make a budget and accountability, don't be expecting us to supply money for future emergencies.
Yeah, you're right. You're wise there. Wow.
And then I was later told by his family that he was very fragile emotionally and I should not have done that.
Yeah. Well, most buttholes are.
And I don't see any opportunity for discussion with them. So we could not understand how they were living at the level they were with the money they were making and her not working most of the time.
Mm-hmm.
But we found out that his mom monitors his cash account and mm-hmm. puts money in when the balance is in the red.
That's shocking.
She's paid off several credit cards mm-hmm. several times and caught him up on car payments.
I got the picture. How can I help today?
Okay. I need support on what to do. I mean, I feel like I know what to do. I mean, I've looked at your website. We've, you know, drawn, but you still feel like such a, you know, have the guilt trip. And then to have his parents, or really his mom mostly, give you the guilt trip double. I guess I just need support on and how to follow through with this.
Okay. Well, what you've got here is his mom is a complete butt. She's raised a butt. Your daughter's being a butt.
Yeah.
And if you participate in this, you are funding butts. I mean, you just can't do this. You just can't.
But why do I feel like such a butt?
You're not. You're not. Because you're the only grown-up in the whole conversation.
Hmm.
You're the only grown-up in the whole conversation. Nothing you told me was harsh. Nothing you told me was controlling or out or over the top or you were interfering in their life. It was all acts of love. And you've been not only told to stay away, people have been rude to you.
And that's probably not all of it.
Yeah. And so, mm-hmm. you know, here's the deal. We love you. We're praying for you. If you guys want to eat a dinner, come over. We'll feed you dinner. We're not going to listen to you whine about your life, though, and we're not going to give you any money. But we love you. Good luck. You know, you remember that part where you told me to stay away or it would be harassment?
Mm-hmm.
I'm taking that part now, seriously. I'm going to stay away. And by the way, when I stay away, my checkbook is with me.
Mm-hmm.
That's how that works. No.
Well, of course, they don't have to come very often because Mom supports them.
Well, she'll run out of that eventually because she's an idiot.
I wonder.
Well, she will. She'll run out of money eventually.
What do we do?
You pray. That's all you can do.
Well, even the future, like
no,
on,
the answer is no.
Will. I mean, on our will.
I wouldn't leave them money.
You wouldn't?
No.
Okay, you wouldn't leave them any at
no,
this point?
No. I told my kids, if you're going to be a doofus, I'm not funding doofus. Because here's the deal. I don't know where you stand, but I'm a person of faith. I'm a Christian.
Mm-hmm.
And God has told me real clearly that in the scriptures that I am managing money that he gave me for him. And I'm supposed to be a good manager. There's the chance of me putting your daughter in my will is zero. Because I'm a good manager.
Mm-hmm.
And I've told my kids, if you're doing heroin, or you decide you're going to run off and live a life of debauchery, or not, you're not walking with the Lord, I'm not going to, I am duty bound by the Lord to not give you his money and fund your misbehavior with his money.
Mm-hmm.
I'm duty bound as a steward, as a manager. I have to. And so just understand, you know, if you're going to run off and live a life of craziness, if you're going to be nasty and mean to us, then we're not going to be funding your life. Now, that can be changed while I'm still alive. You can grow a brain, grow a life, come back together, have some character, rebuild a relationship, and we'll put you back in the will. But our kids, it's real clear. They are entitled to nothing because they happen to be born of Dave and Sharon.
Mm-hmm.
Zero entitlement. Zero. Because it's not my money. I'm managing it for God. It's not their money. They'll be managing it for him. And if they don't see it that way, they won't get any.
None.
Zero.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I've been real clear on that. And we have a little meeting once a year and go over our estate plan. And our family has a family constitution. At the top of the constitution, as for me and my house, we will serve the Lord. And it's not me being mean. I'm just being passionate right now to inject into you because you got so much stupid around you that you need to hear somebody tell you you're smart.
Yeah. And without
the deal. One of the things, if you read Henry Cloud's book, Boundaries, when you're in the middle of a situation where everyone you're in contact with in a situation is violating boundaries, you begin to think you're crazy.
Mm-hmm.
And they are they're travel agents for guilt trips. I mean, they will sign you up for a guilt trip, all of them. And you know what I would tell his mother? Never call me again.
Oh, really? Never call me?
Yeah, I don't want to talk to you. You're an idiot.
Well, she doesn't want to talk to me because I was so abusive to the son.
Yeah, good. Don't call me ever again. Mm-hmm. I don't want to hear any more information through you ever.
Okay. Well,
and when everybody gets cleaned up, you'll be the last one I will reconcile with after I get everybody else straightened up. But you're the problem of this. You're the root of all evil, chick. You are, man, she's bad news. She is an enabler from now on.
Yeah.
And so you need to get Henry Cloud's book, Boundaries. You need to read it. You are not crazy. You are right. And I got to tell you, it's very sad. It's heartbreaking one of your kids is a butt. Your kid's a butt. She's a world-class butt. And I wouldn't give her anything. This is the Dave Ramsey Show. Hey guys, thanks for watching. If you enjoyed this video, click the subscribe button to get the latest content and check out these other great clips from the show.